metastasized esophageal, and then they found it.
Hey, are we on the air? We got a time frame. Joe Williams got us to the place, right? We didn't have the stuff working, but we do have. Joe helped us find the place, and so of course I work here. But Joe's daughter is on the show along with America's favorite superintendent, Kelly Johnson. Now, we're going to talk about reading today. We're going to talk about some of the challenges that come up, and I get a lot of questions about it. And I thought we'd get two people: one from Anderson County Schools, Derek, and then Kelly from Clinton Schools. I want to go on record. I invited Oak Ridge City. They had a conflict with the one person, I guess, that was qualified to talk about reading in the system, and they declined to come. Hopefully we'll hear from them later, and we'll get some stats on how Oak Ridge kids are doing reading and some other things. But we do have two experts here today. That's it. Guys, welcome. I want to know how kids are doing and what we're doing to help them. So tell us a little bit about each of yourselves. You don't talk over each other. You're professionals.
All right, I'll let you go first.
Okay.
So my name is Dara Wade. I work in the Anderson County School System. Mm-hmm. I taught at Norris Elementary for several years, mm-hmm. and for the past 10 years, I have been an academic coach where I work closely with teachers and new hires to our district, and I help with curriculum. I help with assessing kids, just whatever the teachers need to be effective, looking at data, which we're going to talk a lot about tonight. Yeah. And so just trying to help them be the best they can be for our students.
You know, I was telling her before the show, me and Kelly were talking, I've never heard the word academic coach. All the stuff I've done politically and everything, I mean, maybe it's a different title, but that's kind of interesting. I'm glad to know about that. So I guess teachers need somebody to help them focus and to do different things as well. So that's it. How big? Let me tell you what I learned in 10 years I was in the county. The academic challenges of the Anderson County school system are enormous. You go from Norwood to Norris to Lake City, Bryceville, Claxton. That's just a lot of ground to cover.
It is.
And, I mean, you talk about assessing different people and cultures. I mean, Norris isn't a lot like Bryceville. Bryceville, which is an award-winning school, and I'm very proud of that group. And all my wife's in-laws went to Rosedale 40 years ago, so I know New River. We have New River in our family.
Yes.
So everything's different. There's challenges. Whereas Clinton's a more contained environment, Oak Ridge.
It is.
And even though the demographics are different and challenging at times,
absolutely.
I'm sure. And thank you for not closing South Clinton School. We appreciate that. That was 10 years ago. You weren't there, but
we love our South Clinton Bears.
Oh, I love South Clinton. I've been coached on that, but that's where we're at. So reading is took a beat in COVID. I mean, I have a young son and everything. You can't go to school. You're staying home. And I don't care who. And when you're little, that's just hard. Mm-hmm. That's hard. I mean, just unless you have, obviously, parents or partners, and if they're actively participating. But some of them, both of them work, and you got other challenges.
Exactly.
How bad was it? How much correct? I think it's about 2 years, to be fair to everybody. About 2 years. So my question is, we're out of that. I think we have more normative patterns, correct? But those 2 years are gone for those kids. And now they're in fourth grade and fifth grade and sixth grade, and they got behind in first and second and third. What do we do? How do we intervene? How do we catch them up, I guess, is my question, Kelly. Yeah.
Well, I mean, COVID definitely took a hit. You know, we were closed the last 9 weeks of 2020 in the spring. Where we saw in Clinton City was our biggest hit, obviously, is with the primaries. When you're, you know, kindergarten, first, second grade, when you're in those primary grades and you're learning the foundational reading skills, your phonics and your phonemic awareness and fluency, that when you're not in school, that took a big hit, especially where we saw in Clinton City Schools was with our kindergarten, because that last 9 weeks of kindergarten, you are solidifying and putting so many things together for reading foundational skills. We were blessed when you compared us to the nation, though, and I'm going to speak on behalf of Anderson County as well, that Anderson County and Clinton City Schools were very committed to remaining open. So even in the following 2 years, we remained and kept the buildings open. But where we saw the learning loss occur was just in the significant number of absences that we had due to mandated health department quarantines. And then, you know, in 2021, we saw a lot of just mandated quarantines. And at the time, it could be up to 21 days that the kids would miss school because a family member, they had a family, you know, exposure. And so the number of absences we calculated in our small district in 2021 school year when we reopened schools, that due to COVID cases and mandated quarantines, our students missed close to 10,000 school days.
Wow.
Collectively. And so you can't do that and not have some sort of impact, you know, on education. And I think we quickly learned, and the nation quickly learned, that our virtual kids, on average, they do not make the gains that in-person. In-person instruction is where the magic is, especially when you're learning how to read.
I want to hear from Dara on the same thing and tell, because that's a broader experience in a sense. But I'm going to tell you, some school systems, and I bragged on Kelly to government officials and others, but some communities, not teachers, but some communities took a more aggressive tact on COVID, were closed longer, suffered more damages. And I know in elementary schools that closed in that, I think it was 19, wasn't it the late 19 or late 20 when it all hit, where we all closed after
20. 20.
20.
It was 20.
So after 20,
yes.
We closed. And some schools opened in the fall of 20 and mm-hmm. never closed again.
Yep.
I mean, so they weren't hit as bad. And whereas it seems to me, now I live in Oak Ridge, which I thought stayed out too long. They have a business to run. I understand. They have decisions to make. But I really think that our response, well, I don't know. I haven't seen, they're not here to talk about their numbers, but I think you're right. And I think there are some schools, I know some elementary schools in this area who had one case that whole year or two mm-hmm. because of schools of 190, 200 kids. Just schools, not systems.
Right.
And they just managed it. They just took care of them. They stayed in. They studied. So tell us a little bit about Anderson County Schools and how that fared out for you, dear.
So it's a very similar story. We ended in March in the spring of 20, and we have a whole group of kids that missed a fourth of kindergarten and a fourth of first grade, and that's really when you see your most growth out of those students. And so we came back the next year, next fall. Everybody was teaching in masks. We had, you know, the screens up everywhere. Students were in masks. We were trying to be socially distanced as best we could, but we knew we had to be in person. We had no choice. The future of Anderson County depends on us making sure we're giving our best to these kids and doing what we can to help make them stronger readers and writers. But what we ended up with were contact tracing with multiple absences. And so now we have students that have gaps that we have to pinpoint what those gaps are, what's going to be the best way to address those gaps and get them caught up just as quickly as we can.
Did the mask impact stuff when you were there?
We didn't mandate them in Clinton City Schools. So I think you all had a threshold that you did in a kind of a procedure that you followed, but there is, and that was one of the main reasons we did not mandate masks, even though it was a very controversial subject. But we did not, because it's so difficult when you are teaching those foundational reading skills and you're teaching children what a sound sounds like. Mm-hmm. They need to be able to see your mouth and the formation of your mouth.
Right.
And so, I mean, definitely that impacts the success in the foundational skills if your face is covered.
And I could live with it in common areas, gym, indoor recess or whatever, but in a classroom, it's just, I mean, there are kids that did, the kids were drawing in school and doing things, and they were drawing kids with masks. They didn't even know what they looked like, mm-hmm. Three and four, 5 year olds. Mm-hmm. Never got a chance to see who was in the class for the whole year of 20 and 21. That's just tough. That's tough. What 3 year old wears a mask correctly? Or 4 year, you know, they're tugging at it, they're playing and stuff. So I really didn't have a lot of sympathy for that. Now, the problem, it turns out the problem with COVID, as I see it, is 1 out of 100 people are really impacted by it. I mean, my wife's been through a lot, but there's a lot of stuff. But the majority of people, I think, got through it fine, and then they adapted after we better understood it. So what was the fall off? Dara, what was the fall-off in the schools? If you evaluated your second and third graders today or last year that went through 2 years of COVID, how far behind are they?
Well, Let me think about that.
Okay.
As in a quantitative term, what we've had to do is we've had to be proactive about what was our approach going to be.
So you did put reflect and put some kind of program to help them catch up.
Oh, absolutely. And in Anderson County, we pride ourselves in being learners ourselves and trying to find out what is the latest research, what do we need to be doing that's going to best serve our students. And fortunately, our state also really impresses upon the importance of foundational skills. And so when the students came back in the fall of 20, we had implemented the Tennessee Foundational Skills Curriculum Supplement, which is very strong in phonemic awareness and foundational skills. So we had to make sure our teachers were well-versed in that curriculum and were able to use it. And I think that really helped cut back on the loss because we were prepared to meet the challenge ahead.
Mm-hmm. Guys, help me understand, because I really don't know. What is, forget COVID for a second. How do kids learn to read? What do they achieve as kindergartners? You mentioned the last 9 weeks is very important. First grade, second grade. They get evaluated in third grade, statewide. What is the normal growth pattern of their ability to read, like phonics and sounding out, read the book, stuff like that?
It starts with learning letters and sounds.
Okay.
And then you were able to put, like we call them CVC words, consonant, vowel, consonant words together, and then you build on the complexity from there. The brain research is fascinating when it comes to reading because your brain is not programmed to be a reader. You would not read naturally. Someone has to teach you how to do this. And actually, your brain learns it through sound. So you might see Oak Ridge JCs up there, and that's because your brain hears Oak Ridge JCs. And so
interesting.
You have these words. It's called orthographical mapping. This is very technical. I'm sorry, but
no, that's what I'm here for.
You have these words orthographically mapped or overlearned, I guess would be another way to say it.
Who maps them, though? Is it instinct from years of evolution, or is it your brain programs say everybody's different, or how's that work?
It's exposure to these words and these sounds, and so you learn, you know, a B is going to sound like B, and so, you know, in kindergarten, you start there, and you go from there, and then in first grade, you build on that, and you start with letter blends, and then all these vowel teams, and so it's a very it's a very complex process, and you have to be systematic about it, but then you also can't forget about comprehension, because you don't want I have seen kids, I'm sure Kelly has too, that could read a passage, and then when it comes to talking about it, they're like, I have no idea what I just read.
I have
read
one of those, by the way.
So it's a delicate balance of being able to teach
the
code.
It's very interesting, and it makes sense. You know, I was in graduate studies back in the Lincoln administration, back or somewhere, but I was in graduate studies in religious studies and early New Testament, Old Testament. You know, there was nothing written down. People learn, they heard the stories. I mean, in reality, Jesus says these parables, people follow it and they teach other people in the group. But there was a few people, and then obviously we got the books, but most of the teaching was oral. They heard the words. You're exactly right. Mm-hmm. It's recognition, because you think about growing up in your houses, and Joe, this one's on you. You think about growing up in your houses, you didn't write everything down. You talked and you learned and you sounded things out. That makes great sense. I hadn't thought about that. Mm-hmm. And when you program that in, so when they see the words and they interpret them, if they listen on audio tape, and I know some students who cannot do the reading and writing in high school, but if you play it on audio tape, mm-hmm. they make an A on the test. Mm-hmm. They can hear it. They can score.
Yeah.
That's interesting. That's very interesting.
Yes.
Let's take a short break. We'll go to Chandler if he's out there, and we'll take a 2-minute break and we'll come back.
Unlike other health concerns, mental illness is not always easy to see.
D-E-P-R.
Mental illness doesn't show up on a scale.
Bipolar?
Sorting out a mental health concern takes professional diagnosis and treatment.
Anxiety. I thought so.
If you or a loved one has a mental health concern, don't go it alone. For 24-hour free and confidential information and treatment referral, call 1-800-662-HELP. Learn more at samhsa.gov/support.
What if one day you went to your secret hiding place, and instead of what you came for, you found this? What would you do? The truth is, all drug use comes with risk. Before drugs take their toll on you and your family, know that there is help. You can quit. If you or someone you love is struggling with drug use, call 1-800-662-HELP for 24-hour free and confidential information and treatment referral. Or go to samhsa.gov/knowtherisks.
Hello, I'm District Attorney General Dave Clark. My fellow DAs and I successfully fought for new elder abuse laws and procedures that have police departments and agencies using improved tools to protect our seniors. Victims of elder abuse are often unable to recognize or report abuse themselves. They need your voice. If you suspect abuse, contact local law enforcement or Adult Protective Services. Let's work together to protect our seniors.
I'm Andrew Saul, Commissioner of Social Security. Beware of telephone scammers pretending to be government employees. Real Social Security employees will never threaten you. Callers threatening you with arrest or other legal action and demanding money are not from us. If you receive a call like this, hang up. Do not provide them with any form of payment or information. Report the call at oig.ssa.gov.
All right, here we go. Brad's got me refocused. I moved over and I'm trying to focus. But these two were so good, there's really not much reason. So, I love the brain stuff. I mean, I know enough academically to understand what you're saying in different terms of development and how we learn to do things in families and why some kids are verbal and some aren't verbal. And it's interesting. Tell me about, as we started on kindergarten, and we talked about phonics, and we started off, and then we got sidetracked. So what expectations do you have through first grade, second grade? So when they go to take that standardized test that we'll talk about later, what development expectations do they have? Do you have of kids?
You're just going to see it progress, and so
of course, yeah.
in a course of a reading lesson, Dara, you may have to help me out here, but there's five components that you want to build. You want to build phonemic awareness, phonics, fluency, comprehension, and vocabulary. And those are the five different components that you are hitting in every single reading lesson that you do. And so you're just going to start with the simple things as Dara was talking about, and then you just build and it gets to be more complex. But you try to integrate. It's not in isolation. So you're reading text out loud. They're reading to themselves, but then you want them writing about it and talking about it and integrating all of that together.
And then there's the stamina issue, too, because you're expecting, ultimately, an 8-year-old to sit and take a test for 60 minutes. And that's really hard.
That's a long time.
That's incredibly long, yeah. Which is where when we look at the high stakes testing and the issue of, you know, the third grade retention law and some of those things that are coming into play this year, when you look at that third grade reading TCAP test, it is intense. Mm-hmm. It is intense for an 8-year-old for that to be their first standardized assessment.
Is that the first TCAP test? Mm-hmm. Third grade reading?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Any other grades in third grade besides reading? Do they evaluate anything else?
They'll test math.
No, will
math
they?
And science as well, yes. Second grade districts can opt in to a test. It's not a TCAP test, but it is a standardized test based on the second grade standards. It's not mandatory. Districts can opt in. Clinton City Schools does opt in just so that we can use that data to help us, you know, inform third grade.
We have historically, but we're not going to do it this year. We do benchmark testing in second through fifth grade on our own. That is not mandated, but that's what we use to inform where our students are on state standards. And so teachers will use that information and analyze that data to know what students need to work on, which standards, and, you know, how much mastery they have.
Have you allocated more resources towards reading skills and catching up? I mean, have you got more people involved in the classrooms helping kids learn how to read or catch up? Have you allocated resources?
All of our ESSER, the ESSER federal funds that rolled down, all of our ESSER 3.0 funds have been used to address learning loss and provide additional interventions. And then I know both of our counties, we took advantage of a program called All-Core Tutoring, which is we used some of our ESSER funds and then received an additional grant from the Tennessee Department of Ed to where we have some specific students that are participating in something called high-dosage, low-ratio tutoring. And so every day for 45 minutes in each grade level, we've got a qualified tutor who has gone through intense training that is working with three children only. And so the thought and the research behind that shows that that three is almost like the perfect magical number to be able to move the needle with reading using quality research-based reading interventions. Okay. And so both districts are participating in that at all grade levels. And we have looked strategically at our formative and standardized assessments to look to see the kids that we feel like we could move the needle the fastest on to get them caught up with their learning gaps.
Let's go right into formative versus traditional. So my friends in education, there's the legislators want accountability. They want to see the grades. They want to know if the teaching's really getting done. Most of them are teachers, obviously. And you've got these other things. And teachers say, look, we need a formative assessment, a one-time test is not going to get it done. A teacher has a better understanding. I think I agree with the formative assessments in terms of a better way to evaluate the child. I agree with the legislators in that kind of subjective evaluation doesn't give you much standardizability to measure how a school system's doing or a certain thing's doing. But you understand what I'm saying by that? But like, if you do formative assessments and you have I don't even know if it has a grade involved in formative assessments, but you made a good point earlier, both of you did, that look, we test them all the time. We're keeping up with their progress, and those are scores, so we know how they're doing. The one standardized test that they take in third grade, which is this threshold that everybody's putting too much weight on, apparently. Does it affect funding? What happens if your school doesn't have a good grade?
It can affect, by federal law, the federal accountability, it can affect, schools as of this year will receive a letter grade. Mm-hmm. So how the kids score on this one isolated standardized assessment affects a lot about the letter grade that's perceived to the public. Mm-hmm. It can affect your status of whether you're a reward school or a CSI school or an ATSI school.
For us in the audience, define reward school. What does that mean?
Reward school, top 5% of the state, basically. Okay. That's kind of a generic way to say it.
Okay, that's
good. Then your CSI, ATSI schools, those are the schools in need of improvement. And so while right now there's no funding attached, when TESA comes on board next year, there will be funding attached because you're going to get bonus outcome money for every child who is on track and mastered in the third grade, which is the two higher categories on the standardized assessment. And then while there may not be monetary, there is going to be a big significant financial impact with the third grade retention law. Mm-hmm. If we see a significant number of retentions in third grade, that can mean additional staffing, additional learning space. So there's a lot that's rolled into that expectation.
Does that influence your decision on whether you pass a child or not?
The state is saying that if a student does not perform at a proficient level,
he has to stay back or she has to stay back.
There are options. They could attend summer school. They have to ultimately retake the test and perform at a proficient level. There's a summer school option with an attest at the end. If the parent doesn't want to go that route, then they can send them on to fourth grade, but they have to be involved in the tutoring program that Kelly mentioned for the entire year. And so there's a lot riding on the test this year, especially for our third grade. And so with our tutoring this year, that was our top priority to make sure we could serve as many of those third graders in ELA as we could, and then still serve a fair amount of other students in the other grades and subjects.
It's funny you mentioned that because somebody just sent me in a message, and I won't name names here, but in education, they just said, do you have concerns about the new third grade reading requirement to advance to the fourth grade, which is what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Isn't that ironic?
Do you have an hour and a half?
Yes.
Yes. I'll give you my thoughts on that if you have an hour and a half.
Kelly's my absolute favorite of all time. All school systems ever. Kelly is. I just, I don't think that the state's in the best position to judge who should go from third to fourth grade, no matter what the scores are.
Here's the interesting thing, and I'll try to put it in a nutshell, is that these are eight-year-olds who are taking a standardized test for the first time. If you look at the ELA assessment, which is English Language Arts, it is not 100% reading. Mm-hmm. It is, last year, by the percentages, it was 40% writing and grammar, whether a child knows when to use a period or a comma, 60% reading. And on the 60% reading, it is a multiple choice assessment. You cannot determine if a child is accurately reading on grade level when the whole assessment is multiple choice and then grammar and grammar and writing.
That makes sense.
And so we actually went to the legislator and said, we're all about, I mean, there is not a school system out there that's going to argue that we don't want our kids reading on grade level.
Right.
There's not a school system out there that's going to argue that that's an important benchmark. But we also know these are eight-year-olds, and we have a plethora of data that we can use, from universal screeners to benchmarks to running records to anecdotal teacher records, that we could use in conjunction with this one test score to create a portfolio to make an educated decision, and the legislator voted us down.
I had no influence on that. let's talk about blended learning. Is it something we do or want to do, or is the concept popular? You know what that is?
Yeah.
I don't know what that is. So I'm acting like I do. Like blended learning.
We are one-to-one, and Anderson County is as well. And so, yes, there is an opportunity for technology to use to enhance learning. There's an opportunity for technology to individualize instruction and to plug holes. I'm always a firm believer, though, that the most power is in the teacher and the human being that is working with
that.
The student.
I
That's where
that.
We see the impact. It's not in programs. It's not in a device. It is in human interactions with a highly qualified teacher using high quality
right.
materials.
Nothing takes the place of an effective teacher.
I'm going to go back to the beginning. Do we have strategic interventions in place to make, I understand the methodology, but are there other interventions to help these kids catch up? Interventions outside the normal realm of educating? Things that you're doing for people or individual students that were got behind in first, second, third grade, or second, third, or first, second, that you don't normally apply, but there's some extra interventions and strategies being involved to help them keep up. In my day, it'd be stay after school for an hour, you know, but
right.
today it's a little more sophisticated.
I think in Anderson County, we came to the understanding that what they don't need is more of the same, you know, and so we're trying to vary, you know. We're trying to find an effective way to pinpoint what is holding them back from being successful. Mm-hmm. Whether it's, you know, not knowing how about certain vowel tings work, you know, really, really digging down and figuring out what the kid needs, what the student needs, and being able to find some materials, and that the interventionist knows how to properly implement these programs to work with kids.
I'm going to step out. You can't say this, but I can. The 20% that have the struggle the most in academic, and we'll say reading at those levels, 80% of their problems are collateral issues. Home, other problems, mental problems, issues, abuse. I mean, hard for them to focus.
Mm-hmm.
Won't you think?
Which has been exacerbated by COVID greatly.
Oh, everybody's home.
Great. I'm going to tell
domestic
you.
Domestic violence went up 40%.
I
know more about crime than I do education.
Well, we're at all elementary school district, and I will tell you that in the past 2 years, we have done more suicide assessments on students.
The that
level
age?
Of, yes,
wow.
Absolutely, with a plan, with, I mean, it's some intense, you know, we have just seen the anxiety, depression in students, and, you know, we are focusing on taking care of that mm-hmm. mental health aspect as well, because until you take care of that,
right.
it's, I mean, you got the hierarchy of needs. Until we can take care of them emotionally and create safety, it's going to be very difficult. We can provide good instruction all day long, but if they're not mentally ready to absorb it, they're worried about what went home or what's going to go on when
right.
they go home, then it's a whole different ball game.
That's overwhelming.
And I'll tell you, people who don't think it's in our community are very wrong.
Oh,
they are
I can
very
assess
wrong.
That. I can assess that. But that makes the teacher's challenge for Tom and Betty and Mary, and then you got Billy, and Billy's got different issues and requires more time.
Right.
That's tough.
And in Anderson County, we've hired more mental health professionals
yeah.
to help with students. And we've got social workers, and we're making sure kids are coming to school and they are having all those needs met.
Wow. How many staff people do we have in the mental health area? I mean, like overall. I mean, do we have somebody in each school? Do we have a department in the school system?
Well, we have a guidance counselor, a full-time guidance counselor at each school, and then we contract with Ridgeview in Oak Ridge, and we have a full-time certified counselor that provides actual mental health counseling to students throughout the district, throughout the school day. And then obviously your social workers are working on making sure that students' basic needs are met, helping parents connect with resources that are going to help them, you know, have a safe home environment so they can come to school ready to learn. And so it's really all hands on deck. But right. Even with all of those support systems, the majority of it does fall on the classroom teacher, because that's where the child is for the majority of the day.
Sure. Are we getting adequate funding for these things? I know that's a controversial question, a trick question, but let me rephrase it. What areas would you like to see more funding?
What I would like to see is materials not be quite so expensive. We have books that we would love to order, but the shipping costs alone are $5,000, which is...
Where are they shipping them from?
That's a good question.
I got guys who go, me and Brad go get them. We'll take our truck and go get them.
Yes.
Brad? For $2,500, we'll get it done. That's it. I know what you're saying.
For us, it would just be mental health services. But the problem is not only with the funding, but finding the people who are qualified to do the work or willing to do the work. I mean, there is a clear shortage in mental health supports beyond the funding.
They're worn out.
For students.
They're
absolutely.
Just completely worn out. Mm-hmm. I mean, in other collateral type things, not just education, drug abuse, everything, it's just, it's off the charts. You think Panera's got a problem getting people. I mean, it's just everywhere. It's just getting worse and worse. Another reason why teachers probably deserve to be paid a little more. But everybody does. That's kind of an unfair.
Right.
Everybody does. And it's kind of a situation. I think we're blessed with good superintendents.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're good with good visionary. I'm a big fan of the AC. I got to be of your superintendent. So I'm going to be. He's number two. But I mean,
Could you say that one more time for Dr. Parrott?
Dr. Parrott. But. Dr. Perry, that's right. He needs to understand that you're there. But he also needs to understand that Joe Williams is the best school board member in the whole county, no
there
matter
we
what.
Go.
Amen.
There
Joe,
we go.
Hey, Joe is passionate. She's done a
she's
great
very
job.
Passionate.
How long has she been on there? 20, 30 years?
I don't think that long, but
she's been active that long.
She's been active since I was in the fifth grade.
We're going to leave that alone.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know that never comes out right. I always get my step ahead of it. Okay. Let's take a break for 2 minutes, and I'm going to think about this for a second. We're going to ask some more questions on reading in the schools. It's tough when they're smarter than you are. You got to come up with new stuff every 5 minutes. So we'll be right back.
At Social Security, we are always thinking of ways to save you time and make things easier. That's why we created My Social Security. A My Social Security account allows you to access your earnings history and benefits information, request a replacement Social Security card, get a proof of income letter, estimate and apply for benefits, and more. Save time. Go online. Open a My Social Security account at ssa.gov/myaccount. Social Security. Securing today and tomorrow.
Produced at U.S. taxpayer expense.
This is my husband, Alex Hussey. Alex is about 2 weeks away from coming home.
I was playing man on foot patrol, and I stopped on the bomb. Less than legs, my left hand, and an explosion.
And he suffered a severe traumatic brain injury.
As America's veterans face challenges, DAV is there.
There are so many mountains to climb, and we do it together.
With the right support, more veterans can reach victories great and small.
Come on, Alex, take on this mountain. That's what this is all about.
DAV provides a lifetime of support to veterans of every generation, helping more than 1 million veterans each year.
Alex has conquered this mountain. That's something he won't forget.
With the right support, there are no limits.
Look at that smile! You did it!
But there's more to be done and more victories to be won.
This has meant so much.
Thank you, DAV.
Alex Hussey, thank you for your service. Support more victories for veterans. Go to DAV.org.
We should never lose sight of our health. To keep moving forward, let's not forget everything we've learned. Limit the salty food options. Make your own daily exercise routine. And always receive regular checkups. More than anything, we have learned how important these small steps can make a big difference, so we can all continue to move forward together.
Hello, I'm District Attorney General Dave Clark. My fellow DAs and I successfully fought for new elder abuse laws and procedures that have police departments and agencies using improved tools to protect our seniors. Victims of elder abuse are often unable to recognize or report abuse themselves. They need your voice. If you suspect abuse, contact local law enforcement or Adult Protective Services. Let's work together to protect our seniors.
Here we go, between the lines, and we're talking to two of Anderson County's finest educators, one a superintendent, one a, what kind of coach is it again?
Academic coach.
Yeah, that works with teachers, that's fantastic. And works with my good friend Nikki Swisher. I just love Nikki. Everybody in Norris just raves about her, everybody's at her, so she's one of your teachers.
She is.
Yeah, it's one of the good ones,
she's
too.
She's amazing.
And her husband is so committed. Mm-hmm. I mean, he is so, I look for him to get more involved in the educational process, whether it be school board or something else, but he really is committed to that. And he shows it with his Boys Club, Girls Club.
Yes, he does.
But staying on the subject, what's the average classroom size for a kindergartner these days? I mean, is it different in Bryceville than it is in Claxton? Is it?
Definitely.
Okay.
We range from 14 in perhaps Bryceville to 24 in some schools. Grand Oaks could have it.
Is there a limit statewide?
There is. So it's an average of kindergarten through third grade.
Okay.
And you take your total number of students, total number of teachers, that has to be 20 or below.
Okay.
And then for fourth.
When we were younger, and I'm older than you two, but when we were younger, wasn't it a higher ratio in those
yes.
days? Yeah, I thought
that
so.
That was part of the BEP, mm-hmm. just that you had to be within those numbers. And then once you get to fourth grade, it goes to an average of 25. Now, you can take one single classroom. Mm-hmm. So even if I have a first grade classroom and my average in that school is, or average in the district is below 20, I can take that one classroom up to 25 children if I need to.
Right.
But that average has to stay under 20.
Interesting. Do some schools perform better than others in reading?
Absolutely.
Okay. Why?
Well, and research actually backs this up, that your socioeconomic status and your free and reduced lunch rate is directly tied to achievement, just because we know from what she talked about with reading being such a complex issue, your background experiences, your vocabulary in your school, the experiences you experienced before you walked through the door, your exposure to words, your exposure to books, all that plays heavily into how you're going to read. And so when you look at the achievement, that can be directly tied to your poverty level with your school. With TVOS, when we're talking student growth,
acronym,
Tennessee Value Added Assessment System. But this is when they take, so like if I'm a fourth grader and I take a TCAP in fourth grade and then I take the TCAP in fifth grade, they will look at that individual and tell how much academic growth that individual has made in a year. Mm-hmm. And that is not tied to socioeconomic status. So that puts all schools on an equal playing field, because when you think about...
Because the baseline was established in the same
issue. Correct.
That's correct.
And so what's important about that is if I'm in a high-performing school, mm-hmm. I may come into fifth grade and I could have taken the TCAP the first day of school and scored proficient. Well, it's not okay for me to sit there for the entire year and not learn anything new. The job of educators is to take that student yeah. and grow them at least a year.
That's right.
Academically.
That's right.
And so TVOS tells you if you have done that accurately with all levels of your kids.
You know what I found out? This is Oak Ridge school system, and St. Mary's to a degree, but not as much as there. There's not a lot of reading. I mean, I'd say you got a book. Yeah, we're going to do one in class this semester, and that's about it, maybe two. And this is 8th, 9th, 10th grade. And very skilled teachers and very analytical of the works and taught them complex thoughts. But they didn't read a lot. I think that's, I don't know. I maybe it's because I'm from the 60s and 70s but as a kid. But I just think that reading is just having a book in your hand. We had one kid, I used to tease her all the time. She took her ACT in seventh grade. Summer, she took it in seventh grade. She got 32 in reading in seventh grade because she never put a book down.
She read
every day. It didn't matter if she was at lunch, if she was in playground. She always was reading. She just loved to read. and just bringing her mother's a teacher and her grandparents, you know, that works, scientists and stuff.
Well, it goes back to what Dara said. I mean, a lot of it is exposure, and, you know, there's a lot of communities that adopt that campaign of read 20 minutes a day. Mm-hmm. And the research behind that is significant. There's not, yes, there is a science to learning to read, but once you learn those foundational skills,
sure.
Obviously, the more you read,
muscles like anything
the
else.
Better you're going to become, and then the better become, the more you're going to want to read.
If you
and
run
so
up a hill 20
cycle.
Minutes a day, you're going to be in better shape, you're going to be stronger,
exactly.
or shoot basketball 20, you're going to be a better free throw shooter. So it makes sense that if you read, I mean, I remember when I was in, I think it was like third or fourth grade, because Kennedy got elected when I was 5 years old. So I remember he did the school reading, what was her name, that had the 10,000 words a minute thing, you know, where you just looked at certain words. I can't remember, Evelyn Wood. And he did that. So Kennedy would read bills like he learned the phrase and skip the other words and stuff, et cetera. So reading was really important. I mean, we talked about it everywhere we went to read a lot. And I think a lot of kids, including me, I think to a degree, you get tired and bored after 20 pages. You're not used to it. I had to pace myself. Some people can go like this all day long. I don't know if it was attention or what it was, but I could read 8 or 10, and then I'd have to stop and do something different, then start again or make notes. I always like to make notes. I didn't just swallow it. Now, if it was something extremely interesting, it was no problem, but yeah. You could put it down.
Well, when we look at back when even we were in school, the amount of standards was so significantly smaller than what it is now. So now teachers are looking at, you know, many, many standards in ELA and math and science and social studies, and you throw mandated playtime, English language arts reading.
Okay. Yeah.
Then you throw in mandated playtime, mandated PE time, mandated, you know, there's lots of other mandates that take away from the instruction. But we did an analysis when we were looking at this third grade retention law, and there are approximately 90 English language arts standards in third grade. And
wow.
So you look at those standards, that gives each kid approximately 2 days to master that standard. Mm-hmm. And so you look at what is required of them and the amount of time that they are actually in instruction receiving that, the demands are very, very high. And so the expectations are just so incredibly different than what they were when we were
How do you manage all that? I mean, that's just incredible. How do you create a normative experience from all that, not just isolated?
So that's where high-quality curriculum comes in play, because we've talked about socioeconomic differences, and so you need a curriculum that builds knowledge, that kind of levels the playing field. And so, you know, we have an English language arts curriculum that does that, and so everyone learns about the same thing at the same time, but then you can differentiate their work within the subject matter of what they're working on. For example, in third grade, they start off learning about ocean exploration. They look at art, that's the masterpieces that have art as a major theme, and so they learn how to analyze those art pieces. They read articles, they read trade books. And you just keep these conversations going. You have them engaged in writing and reading activities, and that helps build that muscle that you were talking about and that stamina. And then they're able, hopefully, ultimately you want to see that spiral down with more complex text. And because what you start off reading at the beginning of third grade is not the same level that you're reading at the end of third grade. And so you've got to build that gradual ability to get to there.
Interesting. I mean, I would love to have to find out from every high school senior that graduates here, how many people have read A Tale of Two Cities, mm-hmm. how many people have read The Pearl, how many people have read The Grapes of Wrath, and the answer is going to be not many, or less than 25%. Mm-hmm. That's sad. Mm-hmm. Those classics are just going by us, and I'm not I'm an average student, or maybe a little bit above, but not off the charts by any stretch. And I just hope schools are doing that. What do they do after third and fourth grade? Once we get them up to reading level, that may go for better for you. You, how far do you go? Fifth grade?
We're sixth.
Sixth, okay. Mm-hmm. Are fourth, fifth, and sixth middle schoolers, are they reading? Do they have challenges as well?
Definitely. But we continue the reading. They're reading novels. I mean, the reading just becomes more complex. The ideas become more complex. With the writing, you're moving into more argumentative writing and learning how to develop a thesis. And so you're just taking the foundations and making them more complex. But in your fourth through sixth grade classes, our ELA block, or English Language Arts block, is still, you know, approximately 2 hours a day. So a big, significant chunk of time is still spent in that.
And I really think, after looking at it for 50 years, I think that the average effort and understanding by teachers and academic systems today is much more sophisticated than it was 30 years ago. I mean, I think we have a better scientific understanding. But then you got my son and people like his friends and everything that said, I'm never going to use it. Elon Musk, these are their heroes, you know, these guys. And all they need is data and ready to go. And what do I need English for? What do I need history for, Sarah? They kind of like history, but at reading books, they're just not there. You know, I don't know whether they'll ever get there. But I think that depends on your teacher, too. My son had a really excellent 9th or 10th grade English teacher who got him really interested in stuff. So the quality of the teacher can make a difference.
Absolutely. Oh, the quality of the teacher is everything.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I hang my hat on. Mm-hmm. It is that person that is with them. But, you know, we're responsible for a little bit of that. The disinterest in reading, I mean, when you
but
place
you're part of society, too.
Yeah, part of society. But when you place high stakes standardized and you're reading it and the pressure is you've got to perform to this level, I mean, we have to own a little bit of it, that we've taken the joy out of it.
But I'm in the development business, and I work for energy sectors, and we work with DOE, and I do all of those kind of things, and they call me up and they'll say, tell your son to go into cybersecurity. Don't waste his time with anything else. They started at 120. They got a PhD at 300. Blah, 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 blah. And just get into cybersecurity, get into all this data stuff. And that's the way the kids are going, and that's where the jobs are, and that's where other things are. So, you know, if they become great readers, well, they may get medicine or law because, you know, they test well. There's a direction for them, but they better be up to date on data and security and stuff like that, because every job's centered that way anymore.
Right.
I just don't have any technical skills. I had to learn how to read.
Well, I'll tell you, my son is in cybersecurity right now, and he has to be a dadgum good reader to be able to pass the courses.
There you go.
In his coursework.
That's good. That's good. Dr. Parrott reminds me that he is watching. Be careful here.
Dr. Parrott, we love you. You are my favorite. You know you're my BFF.
She made me say that earlier about you being number two. I just want to go on record with that. I tell you, he's the most popular. I knew VL well, I knew all the other guys well, and I worked for them in different times. So, but I'm telling you without question, this guy's the most popular superintendent we've had in the
They love him. They love him.
Yeah, absolutely.
Who else has didn't he have like a cardboard?
And Foster did.
He had a cardboard picture of him.
10.2.
Yes, 10.2. And it took on a life of its own, yes. I think. It may have
had
its own Twitter feed.
He had an image of himself?
Yes, and we also had...
I'm going to do one. What? I'm going to do
full-size stand up at the fair, but then it moved beyond the fair.
Is that like beyond narcissism? What is that?
It's just, we are just crazy about him.
Yeah. That's kind of fun.
He loves us and we love him.
And I sense that from everybody I talk to.
We had a student dress up like him for Halloween last year.
An appropriate holiday for that attempt. He's just, he comes to Miller's Restaurant on Fridays, mm-hmm. Ronnie's Place out, Miller's Cafe. Let me give them a plug. Outside of Quentin. What's the road that comes out across from the high school where Ronnie's Cafe is? Sulphur Spring. What is that? It goes out that way.
Laurel Road.
Yeah. And just great place, and a lot of people in the community go there. But he's always there. Deal hangs around. He's probably getting a free meal or something. But, I mean, you know, I mean, they're all out there. But they come there, and who else is out there? Oh, who's the young man who used to be an Anderson County soccer coach? Great guy. Mm. Madden. I can't remember Madden's husband's name. And actually, his brother-in-law is the one that died tonight, 40 years old.
Wow.
He's got a block right now. I can't remember names. Anyway, we assess them. I'm trying to get – you guys have talked about so much. You two have kind of ran off and left me. But I guess the question comes down to my interest in the whole thing is, do you have enough money? Do you need more teachers? Do you need more stuff? What do we need to do to help these kids? And I think the part that really touched what I think is that some kids just have a harder time. They're in a lower economic strata. They just struggle more. You see a little bit of that in North Clinton. You see a little bit, getting back to the Clinton Elementary, we had some of the best teachers there, you know, just the best teachers there during a lot of years. I know Mary Layton was there, Kathy Ramsey. Yep. I can name a half a dozen, and Bob was out there. I mean, just a lot of people out there did a marvelous job in that area. Josie's mother, Mrs. Hahn,
yes,
taught there for years. Josie worked for me. They ran out of courses to teach her in her junior year. So she came to work for me. She was so far ahead of everybody else.
I believe it.
Yeah, she just, by her junior year at Anderson County, she just said, I need some work. So she'd come in to us and do some work and help us with administrative. Of course, all those kids knew twice as much as we did. Ned Andrews from Oliver Springs, later with Spring Corps, just great kids.
I tell you, the key to North Clinton in your high poverty schools, there again, is you have to hire teachers who have an understanding of poverty and that they're going to come with more to the table that we deal with in the classroom. But their expectations don't waver.
Right.
And I think that's the key to North Clinton is that, you know, we've got teachers who are going to love them and support them, but education is their way out. And right. If we don't believe that they can do it, and if we don't teach our hearts out to give them that opportunity, no one else is going to.
And let me clarify this about North Clinton. Quality of people is as good as anywhere. Great families, love that area myself, et cetera, et cetera. But these are working class people that don't have as many resources as people that may or may live in a higher economic.
The parents area. At North Clinton Elementary School value education so much, and anytime we do anything that open up the school doors, they flood in there and they're ready.
It's like
they're
the
ready
old
to
days,
support.
Yeah.
But it is very difficult when you get up in the morning and you go and you work a full time job and you come home and you're a single mom of three kids. To sit down and work on reading and work on homework, and when you've got dinner and baths and bills and it's just
things the guys don't really know a lot about, right?
Yeah.
You have to work all day and then go do all that. And I did junior achievement there 1 year for fifth grade at Clinton, North Clinton. And I really love those kids. They were this is 20 years ago, but they were great, great kids. Just so involved, so interested in stuff and everything. And just a lot of people have taught in the Clinton Elementary system that we know around. I know Jamie Lynch taught there. I know Cindy Boshears for years. Mm-hmm. And some really high-quality people have been involved in the Clinton system.
What
Anderson County's so spread out, I can't keep up with it. How many employees y'all got? Like 4,000? I'm thinking students, not employees. I'm sorry.
We have about 9 elementary schools.
That's correct, yeah.
And so we have about 121 K-2 or K-5 teachers. Mm-hmm. And so maybe 2,400 students.
Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. And grants play a big role in all of this. I mean, you have grants coming in for reading, for other things, and for propositions. Would you get any extra money like that for reading? Let me go a different way on that. What helps with what props? I don't know if that's the word I use, but what props or what other things help teachers get to where they need to go that cost money? Visual aids.
It's staff. I mean, we use the research-based interventions. We've actually been very blessed with ESSER funds. That has really been a big part of what I think both systems have used to really help close the academic gaps. That's going to run out next year. Mm-hmm. And so when we've started this all-core tutoring, we've put more counselors in. We've put more academic coaches in. We put more social workers in. I think our biggest fear, educational assistants, which you don't get more bang for your, they're phenomenal. But with that money
now, what's ending at the end of this year, the funding for which program?
ESSER, our ESSER federal funding. Will not run out at the end of this year, the end of next year. But
SR
that's going to be
federal funding.
Yeah, yeah. And okay. So we're going to have to ESSER, ESSER.
I am not even going to try to say all those words.
ESSER, and I could emerge.
What does it do?
It's basically COVID money.
Stimulus money.
Federal stimulus money.
And you used it for staffing?
Yes. And for technology to help, especially when we needed it that first year for those students that were still virtual. But the majority of it went to people.
And that's
going to
go away.
So when that runs out, that's going to be a conversation we have to have. Because we're seeing great results from our all-core tutoring.
How much money in your annual budget is being spent on that in Clinton? On that extra? How many positions are they funding?
Well, in ESSER, we got three rounds of it. So we got ESSER 1, ESSER 2, and ESSER 3. Clinton City Schools probably saw a little bit over $2 million for our small district.
Each year?
No. It was one-time money.
Okay.
It just kind of ran out at different.
How many years did you?
So our ESSER II will run out this year. ESSER III runs out the following year. If I'm not mistaken, and Tim Parrott can text you if I'm wrong.
Tim, get on that phone.
Tim texts out how much ESSER III money you got. Obviously, he got significantly more because his district is
bigger
larger.
District, sure.
But that's been a real key pot of money that has helped us do some
Same
of these additional
there.
Things.
Absolutely. Yes. We have more interventionists in our buildings. We have more educational assistants that, you know, they're expected not to be down there making copies. They're expected to be sitting with kids, working with kids to help push those kids along.
So if let's take it this way. We say we're going to have to eliminate five positions in the Clinton Elementary School if we don't get money. So we got to go to Scott, and we got to go to Wendy, and we got to go to these people. We got to say, look, maybe we need to think about paying $250,000 more a year and getting this done.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
It's going to have to come from somewhere if we want to sustain it. But I think at that point, the beauty is data should always drive our decisions.
Yes.
So I think it will be on me to look at the data to see, have these positions really impacted us to a significant degree to justify keeping them in place?
Well, you pretty much justified it in this show.
Yeah. Well, the justification is there. Yeah. The justification is there.
You're going to have to go to city council
Absolutely.
And figure that out.
Absolutely.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you got some good people.
I think the unique thing about the way all of this works is the way that we run intervention. So you've got grade level standards that you have to teach, and then you have kids that can't meet those grade level standards that we need to fill in the bricks, fill in the gaps to get them to grade level. So we have core instruction time throughout the day where all students are working on grade level material. And then 45 minutes out of that day, which rotates at different times for each grade level to where first grade 45 minutes is at one time, second grade's at another time. Then during that 45 minutes of time, we will look at all second grade students and what they need and put them in groups according to what skill deficits they have, or it could be an enrichment group where we need to push them further. Mm-hmm. And then we take all of our teaching assistants, all of our grade level teachers, anybody humanly possible that's available in the school at that time gets pumped in to do intervention.
Do you two lose students to higher paying systems, lose teachers to higher paying systems? Not very
I don't often. Struggle with that.
You don't struggle with that anymore? Mm-hmm.
Occasionally we will have somebody leave the system.
That's different though. It's kind of like when you look at law enforcement jobs, they go to the plants, right? Yeah. They go out 4 or 5 a year, and it's hard to replace that sometimes.
I don't lose teachers to higher-paying systems because I do believe the culture and the supports that you provide help. I mean, people are going to stay where they're happy. Mm-hmm. And I do believe, now, do teachers need to make more? Absolutely. No one's going to argue with that. What I'm seeing, though, is teachers are leaving the profession.
Yes.
Yeah.
They just, the demands.
It's a little
bit
intense the last few years.
It's very. It's a different ball game. Mm-hmm. And universities
are we getting back to? Are we getting back on track? Do you think?
I think we're having conversations to get back on track,
and we're trying some grow your own strategies across the district. But
what does that mean? We're having conversation. You're very impressive. I want to tell Joe, you did a good job raising her. I've known Kelly. I mean, Kelly's a Hall of Famer, but I've never met your daughter, Joe. She is impressive. We're having conversations to get back on track, so we're not there.
Well, I don't know that you ever arrive. I mean,
well, that's a nice subjective philosophical answer, but are we back to where we were 7 years ago or six years ago? Are we back? Okay,
no.
Why?
I mean, I will tell you that we used to go to job fairs, and like we always every year do UT job fair. I would come back with a 3-ring binder full of resumes that, I mean, we really got to pick, you know, go through them, and you don't find those. We have had openings, maternity leave openings, that for the first time ever we did not have an application to even interview.
Wow.
And that's a whole different situation, and it has happened quickly.
We got 2 minutes left. What do you want to say, people? Tell parents something. You're our new star. You go ahead.
Oh, be supportive of your teachers. Read with your kids.
That's what I was going to say when it was my turn, yeah.
20 minutes a day, right?
20 minutes a
Read
day.
Read 20 minutes a day.
And make it fun. And reading should be enjoyable.
And you know what? I'll jump in front of everybody. If you got 20 minutes to watch a television show, you got 20 minutes to read your
Absolutely.
Kids.
Absolutely.
You do.
Ball games aren't that important, that's important.
And honestly, you can leave the science of reading up to us. Mm-hmm. Leave the science of reading up to your teachers to teach foundational skills. Just read with your kid. You read.
Read to the kid.
You reading to the kid does just as much good
as the kid reading
themselves.
It to.
Yep.
Unbelievable. Okay. What do you need? What would you like? Tell me something good. What if you had a wish list and you could get anything you could within reason, what would you get for your schools or for your people? 1 minute.
I would say revisit the third grade retention law for anyone who is listening. That is